development of the country and the total industrial scenery in Nepal is degradation of the industry. I would say deindustrialized, because we are going backwards, they are moving forward. This is a very serious sign of underdevelopment of the country, and we all have to take a very serious note of it, because recently, even some few years back, we had some industries were coming up, but they are also now, most of them are closed. Most of our industries don't work under full capacity. Very less industries are working in full capacity. Most of them are operating over 50% of their capacity, and this is a very serious sign of development of the country. Next. Now we come to the third sector, I have called it circulation capital sector. Circulation capital means, the industry means is the production capital. In the industry, the capital is used for production purpose. But there is another set of capital which doesn't directly participate in production, like merchant capital. So which does engage in trading of goods, then merchant capital. Then there is the financial capital or the banking capital, which also doesn't directly participate in production, but just engages in interest making. And this type of merchant and financial capital, I have a type to analyze. Though I told you in the very beginning, this ratio of this merchant and financial capital is increasing, which is contributing about 52% of the GDP. So that is, this proliferation is there in the recent years. But if you just see the trade, first see the trade of Nepal, next. You see, in the earlier phase, in the first phase, Nepal, Kathmandu is to be an entrepot center between India and China, Tibet. So, traders from India used to come to Kathmandu, and traders from Tibet also used to come to Kathmandu, and this was the center, it was the hub of trading. So that way, in the initial phase, our economy, our trade was quite developed. In the next phase, after the Suruli, then the second phase, is after the Suruli Treaty, this was slowly it was broken up. And again, now that we have started trading separately with Tibet and separately with India. That was the second phase. And now the third phase, after the 1950s, when Tibet was liberated and integrated in China, now this was totally stopped, and now our trade is only tilted towards India. So this way, our external trade also getting totally distracted, and we are getting totally dependent on India. Next. If you see regionally, you see in the, before the 1950s, our, most of our trade, you know, the takes place in the north-south dendrite, or along the river basin, Karnali, Gandaki and Kosi basin, from the north-south, our trade takes place, and mostly from the, there is a trading center in the, along the Indian border, Bhairava, Thori, Birganj, Dhanpur, Pratnagar, Nepalgan, Dhangadi, and there is passes like Mustang, Raswa, Kodari, Dimathanga. So that these are the areas the trade from north and south used to take place, and traders from the middles used to go to the south and the north, and trading used to take place that way. So this way we had a interaction or a territorial linkage on both sides, from towards the north and the south. But after the 1950s, when the northern side was virtually closed, we were totally tilted towards the south. Now all our trade now takes place from the south. And from the south, even within the country, you see, there is nothing to be given from the hill to the sky. Most of the goods are purchased from trading centers bordering India, Dhangadi, Nepalganj, Birganj and all these things, and the people go to the south and purchase their goods, and they don't have anything to sell. So that is the whole thing, trading is tilted towards the south. So this extroverted nature of our trade has developed after the 1950s. Next. And then about, if you analyze the nature of the exchange, what I have called unequal exchange is, if you analyze our trading pattern, what we sell mostly the private products, agricultural products we sell, and we import the finished products, the industrial products. So naturally, the industrial products are more high value added. There are more value added, and the industrial products have less value added. When you exchange between primary products and the secondary products, then the naturally the value flows from the primary sector to the secondary sector. So this way, the inherent unequal exchange is draining our economy, because we mostly of our the machineries, motor vehicles, chemicals and drugs, we import and we just sell some pulses, tea, ginger, all the primary products. So that way, this type of trade results in net outflow of value from our country to the foreign countries. So we are the net losers in this trade. In the qualitative term, in the quantitative term, we, you know, our trade balance, you know, before the Tripoli Treaty, we used to export 5 times more than we used to import before the Tripoli Treaty. But now, right now, this year, our export-import ratio was 1:8. Now we import 8 times more than what we export. The total is the 40 times we have gone backwards. So this type of unequal exchange and dependency in foreign trade is hampering the development of the country. This is one of the factors which is leading to the underdevelopment of Nepal. Next. Then now coming to financial capital and foreign debt. Because the under component of circulation capital is finance capital, which doesn't directly take place in production, mostly engage in interest seeking. This type of capital is called finance capital or banking capital. In Nepal's case, in recent years, there is tremendous proliferation of financial capital. In 1982, when I first gathered my data, that time the commercial banks had deposits of only 4 billion rupees. Only 4 billion rupees they had, our commercial bank. But now, this year, there are 1200 billion rupees. From 4 billion to 1200 billion, in fact, 300 times deposits had increased in the commercial bank. So that is financial capital has a quantum jumped over the year. But what is the nature of this proliferation of banking? If you just see it, it doesn't go to the productive sector. Most of it is invested in the real estate or the purchasing of goods. It's the higher purchase. And the real estate, most of the money goes there. And most of the money is concentrated in Kathmandu Valley. More than 50% of this banking activity takes place in Kathmandu Valley. And that also doesn't go to the estate sector. You see? And so, and that's the mismatch of deposit and credit. Most of the deposit takes place from the rural areas or the outside Kathmandu, and most of the credit flows towards Kathmandu or the urban area. So this type of thing has led to a serious unequal development in the country. And this parasitic capital, I would like to call, which doesn't participate in production, doesn't produce goods, but just makes money just through interest. That make money making money. You see, this type of financial capital is not good for the health of the country. This is one of the reasons of underdevelopment of Nepal. If we have to develop it, then all this money, you see, the total money we have in the financial institution, total asset of the banking and the financial institution is 1700 billion rupees. 1700 billion rupees. Do you know what is the total GDP of our country? The latest GDP is 1900 billion. Almost total GDP of our country is equals the wealth of the financial banking capital. So, but and that big amount is being wasted on in unproductive activity. So this way we can never develop the country. So we have to make a serious intervention so that this money, which is being accumulated in bank and financial institution, must be invested in productive sector. Only then we can develop our country. So this is one aspect. The other aspect are the foreign debt. of course, we can totally do away foreign grants and loan. But if you see that trend over the years, it is rising. In the 1970s, per capita debt was only about 150 rupees. But now, 20,000 rupees. Per capita debt, if every individual, every child who is born in Nepal, burns with a debt of 20,000 rupees. So this is increasing every year, and the interest we have to pay also is getting very heavy, and the debt to expert earning ratio is getting over 600%. Total our expert earning is only about 60 to 70 billion rupees, and our foreign debt is about 400 billion. So that means about more than 600%, six times more debt we have than the foreign exchange earning. So this is not sustainable. This way also our capital is getting drained away from the country and cannot be utilized for a productive purpose. So this also needs to be reversed if we have to develop our country. Next. Friends, now in the last section, now I'll tell what is the impact of all these things on the spatial organization of the country. Because in Nepal, as you know, I told you earlier, the 13 regions, mountain, hill and the Tarai, and the east, central and the mountain, that way, if you see the development and underdevelopment pattern getting manifested over the space, it is historically in the initial stage, there is high mountain in the north and the forested Tarai belt, and most of the population was concentrated in the mid hills. In the initial stage like this. In the second stage, when there was deforestation in the Tarai and when the Tibetan passes were controlled, then most of our population started shifting toward the south. Gradually the shift toward the south you can see. And the third, in the ninth, the final phase, the total shifting, all our urban areas, urban centers, now they are in the southern area, and our total population is shifting toward the south. Now the more than 50% of our population is shifted toward the south. So this type of population shift and special organization is creating an imbalance in the development of the country. Rather, to have a balanced development, our population spread also has to be balanced, and the development of urban areas also has to be in a balanced manner. But the general trend has been the shift toward the south, and the population is shifting, economic activity is shifting, urban centers are shifting. So that's why this way the country cannot have a balanced development. Next. And these are the settlement patterns, diametrically sketched. In the mountains, we have the nucleated type of settlement. In the river valleys, in the mid hills, we have very scattered settlements. When in the Tarai, we have nucleated settlements in the Tarai. This is the general pattern. Next. And about the settlement system, how it is developing is mainly in case of Nepal, it has been totally dominated by Kathmandu Valley, and in the recent year tilted toward the south. The Kathmandu Valley was the earliest citadel of civilization, and the whole economic and administrative activity was centralized in Kathmandu. So the Kathmandu developed, and the urban area, urban center was concentrated in Kathmandu, and most of the countryside was the rural area. And in the recent years, now the bordering areas of India, new towns have come up. So that way, if you see the regional structure of Nepal, or the market system of Nepal, on the one side, there is a Kathmandu centric development, and on the other side, there is the India-oriented, extraverted-oriented. So the Kathmandu centric, monocentric, and the extraverted. This pattern of special organization is not a very healthy sign for a balanced development of the country. And the administrative wise, though this was a earlier sketch, but still we follow the same administrative system, because our settlements or the urban areas are most still based on the administrative function rather than the economic and the industrial function. wherever the administrative areas are concentrated, the urban areas sprout there. So they say the village and town panchayat or the town committee, then the district headquarters, then the regional headquarters, then the national capital. So this type of hierarchical development has developed in the country. Next. Now, in this map, I have tried to capture the overall development of the country. What is the development map of the country? In this, I have chosen, as I told you, the agriculture, industrial and other development process also. I have chosen certain indicators of agriculture development, industrial development, general economic development and social development. Of these four subgroups, I have chosen 13 indicators, and through the principal component analysis, I have drawn this composite level of development, and I have mapped in the 75 district. With this shows what is the regional distribution of development in the country. You can clearly see the first most developed area is the Kathmandu. There you have the only Kathmandu. Then the second most developed is in the eastern area, and then you have the Chitwan, Nepalgan, Kaski, and then you see most of other areas are very less differentiated. So overall picture of development in Nepal is developed in very less differentiated. Few areas are highly developed like Kathmandu, Eastern Tarai, or the pockets adjoining the Indian border. Only exception could be Pokhara because of various factors. Otherwise, in most of the countryside, very less differentiated. All others are more or less the same level of underdevelopment, most of the countryside. So this is a sign of overall underdevelopment of the country. Next. And if you see the region, if you can see the regionally, as I told you earlier, Kathmandu has developed, historically developed, even to this day, as a main nucleus of development, so that all the activities at attracted towards Kathmandu, they converge into Kathmandu, and from Kathmandu, they are connected with the outside world. From the airport to the other area, you see, most of the people or most of the economic activities flow towards Kathmandu, and from Kathmandu, they flow to the foreign country. So this, this is one major scenario, major process. The other is from the Tarai-based towns, they partially interact with Kathmandu and they partially interact with India, with the foreign country. So this is what I have said, is mono-central and extraverted center. On one single center, one single point, Kathmandu is dominating the whole structure of the country, and that is also getting extraverted or joined, linked to the foreign country. This type of regional structure is not a healthy sign of balanced development of the country. Next. So then, in terms of Marxist method of contradiction, because you see everything in contradiction, because there is a motion, there is a dynamism through contradiction within the thing. So what is the contradiction in this region, Nepal? In the high mountains, man is very sparsely populated area, so man plays a very less role, nature plays the major role. So there the contradiction is between man and nature. Among the men, there is very less class differentiation. Rich and poor gap is virtually non-existent in the mountainous area. There, the man's struggle with nature, not between man and man. So this type of situation is there in the mountain. In the hill area, there is a triangular country. Class, there is a class differentiation between the rich and the poor, or the very social groups, between the very social groups, and also nature. So this is the nature of contradiction in the hilly area, and in the Tarai area, the nature plays a very less role, and there the major contradiction is among the social groups and social classes. So this is the dynamics of the Nepalese society at the present. Next. Friends, now finally, before coming to conclusion, what I have said, what does this mean there? All these factors, by the less differentiation of the economy, is still dominated by the subsistence agriculture, less development of industry, very high expansion of the finance capital and foreign trade dependency. This is the manifestation of the problem of transition of a pre-capitalist society, hybridized by endogenous and exogenous factors to higher social purpose. Because this has been the problem, because since the Sugauli Treaty and since the process of this endogenous dynamics and the exogenous dynamics started taking place in Nepal, this natural process of development has been blocked and Nepal has been hybridized into a pre-capitalist state, and this transition to capitalism, transition to higher social state has been blocked. This is the conclusion of my thesis, and this needs to be broken. That's how I had concluded, and after with this thesis we had started our people's war. Maoist people's war, I don't know, you may like it or I don't want to talk about it, but people have very big misconception. Maoist started people's war just the whim of fancy of some leaders without any clear cut motive or plan. This is not so. In fact, the Maoist people's war was totally based on this thesis. It was the, I have written a booklet, if you have seen it, a politico-economic rationale of Maoist people's war. This was the politico-economic rationale, because this needs to be broken up. The for hundreds of years, Nepalese society has been hybridized into a pre-capitalist formation through the Indonesian exogenous process. This needs to be broken. This was the thesis, that's why we started the rebellion of the masses of the people. Not only the class, but different sections, different ethnic groups, different regional groups, gender, and the caste groups. So we mobilized all these people to rebel against the old state, so that we will destroy, shatter the old feudal structure, and that will pave the way or make a ground for higher social formation. So that is how this Maoist movement and the other movement, Madhesi movement and other movements, and the people's movement of took place in Nepal. And I think this is more or less shattered. Second, I wouldn't say shattered, but they have second. Fundamentally second is the old system, and now in this process of transition for this, now what do we do then? Now through this democratic process or through the political, economic and social intervention, we need to do three things that I have concluded. First is we have to restructure the state on federal basis. So federal restructuring state has originated in this state, usually. It just, if you will say, it just came up through some emotional outburst of some people. It's not that just emotional outburst. Because of this regional study of the country, I came to the conclusion, if we have to have a balanced development, if we have a rapid and balanced development of the country, we need to have a federal restructuring of the state. So I will not go what is the basis of federal restructuring, it is under debate, but the federal restructuring is necessary, because so far the mono-centered state centralized in Kathmandu Valley cannot deliver development to the whole countryside. So we have to go for federal restructuring. This is the one prescription I have made. And the second is, Nepal over the years has been totally dependent on India. Not only economically, even the physical connectivity is mostly taking place towards India. So this is not a good sign for the national sovereignty, Indian integrity and Indian development. So if you have to develop Nepal as a independent and sovereign country, then we need to develop Nepal as a vibrant bridge between India and China. So in the olden days, in the olden times, the high Himalayas were very inaccessible, but now in the modern age, the Himalayas cannot act as barrier. Because there are various means, technological means, to transcend over the Himalayas. So we have to build Nepal as a vibrant bridge between India and China. Now we have to look towards the north. So I told you, we can totally do away with India, because we are historically, geographically, otherwise connected closely with India. That relation is there, but not to the extent of total dependence on India. Now we are totally dependent. We 2/3 of our trade takes place with India, and all our physical connectivity takes place with India. So for every minor sundry things we go to India. But China is developing as a very powerful country and already as a second largest economy. So for the national interest, we need to have a balanced relation with both of our neighbors, and we should develop as a vibrant bridge between India and China. I think this is the second conclusion I have made. And the third is, we need to embark on the path of inclusive. First, we need to have a development, fast development. We have to make a capitalist transition, because this feudal autarchy has to be shattered. Economy, the agriculture, industrial and other sectors have been stagnant over the years. That needs to be shattered. So we need to have a high rate of growth on the one side, then but it has to be inclusive as well. But the benefit of development has to go to the people, different sections of people. If the different sections of the people do not get benefit out of development, that development is meaningless. So that's why we need to have a rapid, inclusive development. I think this is what we need to embark upon. And friends, with this, I would like to conclude my remarks. I think I have had a very long presentation, but I wanted to share my ideas with you, because this thesis needs to be developed. It was written 30 years ago, but things have changed, but more or less they are unchanged. Things have changed also, they are the more or less remain the same. So I wish some of you could carry forward this project, move ahead, analyze the situation of Nepal, analyze the problem of development and underdevelopment, and embark on the path of converting this great country into a prosperous nation, which all we can be proud of. Thank you.
Thank you, Right Honorable Prime Minister Dr. Bhattacharya. Your presentation I observed more than expectation, and he analyzed throughout our whole nation. This is very absolutely true, and our students may follow his path to conduct the conduct research. And then I would like to once again congratulate, thank you from our side. Thank you, Dr. Gauram Bhattacharya. Thank you very much. And then I would like to give one souvenir.
May we put some question? We have that question.
A short question.
Thank you, Dr. Bhattacharya. It was very extensive and very elaborating, enlightening lecture. We really benefited from your lecture. And I have one question. In your presentation, you presented that one of the barrier of our agriculture is our mainstay, and the development of agriculture main stumbling block is the land holding. It is just 0.68 hectare per capita is our land holding. It is the stumbling block. But in the past, your party, the Maoist party, tried to put in our constitution the limitation in the land, even 10 rupees or something. When land holding becomes so small, then how can we develop our agriculture sector when we put ceiling on land holding? Even not for the who rent from the land, even for agriculture, who indulge in agriculture, how can they develop if they have a small land holding? Thank you.
Okay, this is one aspect where I didn't elaborate. The other side of this land holding is very still very unequal land holding. This is the average. Average is less than 1 acre. But there are some big landholders who still hold hundreds of acres of land in very fictitious names. So this land has remained unproductive. If they utilize it productively for industrial and commercial purposes, well and good. But if you see most of our landlords, holding groups who are in a high bureaucratic position or political leadership, they are based in Kathmandu, but they will hold land in Bardia, Bange, moral, you see. So this type of thing still prevails. So what we mean to say is, in the mountain and the hilly area, there is no very less large holding. Most of this, there is even equal distribution of land. But in the Tarai area, mostly in the far western Tarai, there is still uneven skewed whole land holding, and for that needs to be redistribution. This is the position of our party. I think this is, everybody is agreeing. We have already agreed we will have a scientific land reform, whereby we will put a ceiling, reasonable ceiling, not that it will lead to fragmentation, but these big landholds, either these landlords should themselves cultivate the land in a commercial and industrial way, or they should leave the land for those who want to cultivate it. For that we need to bring out a scientific land reform. But I agree with you also, we shouldn't be too fragmented also. If the land parcel is less than 1 hectare, it can be very productive. So we should encourage land pooling and or the cooperative holding of cultivation of land. This way agriculture can take place. But I still think there is a validity of scientific land. Thank you.
Yeah, some questions. If really the agriculture, who is the farmer, who is the big farmer, can wants to have 100 bigas of land, and he wants to make it very professional and business type of agriculture, what would be your party's stake on it?
You know, we can give larger land only to those who want to cultivate in a commercial and industrial way, but we need to make some land selling. So that the excess land can be redistributed to people, to the peasants who really want to cultivate the land.
Next, so you actually analyze the cause of underperforming of your party, but your party and including yourself seems a bit confused on how to tackle those problems ahead. So still, in one way, you have to go in the path of the development with need of peace and political stability. On the other hand, your party is still in confusion of how to proceed ahead, whether to pursue the path of mass struggle or whether to go in the capitalist way of development as you have forwarded. So, your view, what is the right path for the for taking Nepal into the path of the development, and how should we proceed ahead?
No, there is no confusion, you see. Theoretically and philosophically, class struggle is a continuous process. As long as classes are there will be struggle. So that is a philosophical level. At the practical political level, right now, the political class struggle against the feudal, centralized, autocratic state has more or less been completed. So now we are embarking on the path of what we call in the market term, bourgeois democratic or the capitalist revolution. So the task, political task at this stage, now the next stage is to develop the productive forces, to develop industrial, national industrial capitalism. I don't know whether I have been able to convince correctly, though the capitalism is getting developed, but the capitalism is getting more of a dependent capitalism, not a self-reliant, independent capitalism, the productive capitalism. So we want to develop the productive forces in a industrial capitalistic way, so there is no confusion about it. We shouldn't be worried about the class struggle, but that is a continuous process. But right now at a political level, our task is not to waste class struggle, but to waste struggle for economic development. Our part is very clear, and at least I am very clear.
Thank you very much. Next question.
Sure. So, this is probably considered on in my opinion, this thesis is probably concentrated on Marxist analysis. May I know how Marxism addressed the dialectical metallism? Addressed the dialectical metallism?
Dialectical metallism is a philosophy. So Marxism is based on that. Marxism is a overall ideological or political thought or the philosophy. So Marxism constitutes three components. One is the philosophical aspect. The philosophical aspect of Marxism is dialectical and historical materialism. Then the political economic aspect, where it believes in concept of surplus value. And the third aspect is the scientific socialism, where it believes society will move towards a stateless and classless society through various stages of revolution. So So, in totality of this is Marxism, but dialectical materialism is a philosophical aspect, philosophical branch of Marxism. So, we totally subscribe to that. The base root of Marxism is dialectical materialism. Dialectical materialism, as I told you, is everything is made of unity of opposites, positive and negative, constitute every branch, every cell, everything in society. So there is a constant struggle between these two opposites which provides dynamism or motion for the development of society. So this is the basic formulation of Marxism, and dialectical materialism is the basis of Marxism. So we totally subscribe to it.
Thank you very much. Due to scarcity of shortage of time, I request Professor Sri Krishna Shrestha to hand over this is our publications. And this publication is South Asia Journal of Public Policy and Governance, which is a peer review journal published from our department. This is a worldwide circulation. That's why, and another is from our department, we conducted a nationwide survey, Citizen Trust, and the status of the Citizen Charter, implementation of the Citizen Charter. This I will request to hand over Professor Sri Krishna Shrestha to the Bhattrai. This book I have written myself, and I would like to hand over to the organization. And similarly, I request Professor Rabindra Dhaka to give this token of publication from our department to the Minister Isila Hemi.
Sir, you will be the Prime Minister of
India. I also would like to hand over this my book. This is my publication. And
if you allow me any last question to Dr. Gaurav Bhattrai, since you are talking about the structure of the society, and federalism seems to be one of the main agenda for this structure, could you just tell 5 points of identities and 4 points of sovereignty?
The five bases of identity are the ethnic identity, linguistic identity, cultural identity, geographical identity, and historical identity. These are the five bases of identity, and the four component of economic viability. I think the administrative, economic, territorial, and the
infrastructure.
It's total about economic issues.
Also, administrative viability.
Administrative.
You are trying to lag me.
Any man, I can explain it to you.
Thank you.